morning. There's just a few of us here, but we are mighty in spirit. Let's stand up and worship the Lord together. 3, 4. Welcome to Pathfinder Church. Welcome to this time of worship. We come here today to choose once again to follow Jesus, like we just sang in that last song. And gathering to worship and following Jesus is all about seeking God's kingdom first. Jesus said it like this in the book of Matthew. He said, "Seek first his kingdom. Seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well." And I like to think of Sunday morning worship as our weekly reminder. It's our weekly reminder of all the things that are important in life, all those things, and we are called to seek God's kingdom first. We're going to sing a song about that. It's a new song. I think you're going to like it. Sing with us. If you're joining us online, please drop a comment. Say hi to us. Let us know you're here. Let's go before God and worship him. 1, 2, 3, 4. Thank you.
treasure in hope. Even the breath that I breathe is not my own.
Everybody, I'm here with what you need to know about the life of this church. So let's dive right in and get to it. First off, just a reminder, next Sunday, July 10, there's just going to be one worship service. We are blessed to have the band Westward Road coming to provide our music that day. And so hopefully you will join us here in person or online for that and be ready to have our 8:45 service folks along with us for that service. It should be a pretty amazing time of worship with them. And secondly, we have just a reminder that we're doing a Jesus Loves Kalamazoo Grill and Prayer Night, or Prayer and Grill Night if you want to read it in order, Monday, July 11th, starting at 5 o'clock. This is a great way to serve our community as a family, because it is for all ages. Even the young ones can come and participate and volunteer in serving our community through Jesus Loves Kalamazoo. You can see the website right there on the screen. If you need some help signing up, maybe you're not quite tech savvy, please just reach out to one of the staff people. We can help you out. There's stuff for every age and physical capability. So let us know if you're interested and need some help signing up for that. And last but not least, it's kind of children's moment / announcements. If you aren't aware, we had our day camp program here this past week. We had about 40 children here along with staff from Bayshore Camp that were available. They came and ministered to our children. Just to give you an idea, there were 40 children here. Only about 20 of them are church or child care affiliated. So that means that our congregation was able to reach another 20 children out into our community, and that in alone and of itself, being able to reach and teach about Jesus to our community is our goal. So check out this video that has some pictures of our week. Again, just thank you for those that came and served food while the kids were here, or if you prayed for our program all week, I appreciate that too. And I'm going to go take a nap because I'm exhausted. So let's move on with our worship service.
So I have been standing in this spot, or maybe on that spot right there, pretty much every Sunday for 11 years, saying something about why we give and why we are blessed to be able to give and to keep this church a place where the Word of God is heard and we get to share life together. I'm mindful of an interesting thing that I don't know if you noticed in those pictures as the slides went across the screen. except for the climbing wall, everything that I saw there is really a part of this church, a place that there's room enough to shoot arrows and not have anybody in the way and behind them. The softball field, there's the fire pit area out there, there's the gymnasium, there's the downstairs, there's this, there's all of that. I'm thinking it's like its own summer camp, but that's our church. We have this facility, this physical property. And yet, I think most of us quickly understand that's not what this church is. This church is you and me. It's the people. And I'm grateful that I get to share life and faith with my church family. And so I don't need to be reconvinced on a weekly basis why I give and how blessed I am to be able to give. So that basket that's back there as you first come in or as you leave, where you can put your offering, that is a holy place. It's a holy giving. Would you pray with me? Thanks be to you, O God, for all the ways that you make possible our life, and that in our living in this human existence, you provide to us this family of faith. And we're grateful for this church. But we do not give to maintain just a building. We give to bring life to those who would hear the good news of Jesus. And we want to be about your work. But we thank you for the work that we get to do together. Hear our prayer of thanksgiving, even as we give, in Jesus' name. Amen.
We're going to sing a song, and I invite you to stand up as we do this. This is in preparation of the sermon, so we know that the Holy Spirit is here working in our midst, and sing the song I ask as a prayer that God open up our hearts to hear his voice today. Let's sing.
There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. No prayer can compare. You're our living home. Presence, Lord.
Good morning, beloved. For those of you who don't know me, I know we have some visitors here. I am Brother Don. I'm one of the pastors here. You've met Pastor Ron already up here for the offering time, and Pastor Jake will be up in a little bit. And you met Miss Christina, who our children's director, and you've met Steve Bukema, who is our worship leader as well. We welcome you in the name of Jesus Christ. For those of you who are online with us, either today live or later on in the week, we also welcome you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We are in the very beginnings of a sermon series entitled In the Grip of Grace. In the Grip of Grace. Our opening sermon was last week. Now, I want to share with you that if you're visiting with us today, we're jumping in talking about one of the characters that we talked about last week, so that we introduced last week. So my encouragement to you is, after the service is done today, sometime during this week, go to our website, pathfinderchurch.com, and under the worship tab, there is our podcasts and our videos of our worship services. Go listen to that sermon from last week, or you can look at it on our YouTube channel as well, Pathfinder Church Portage. Make sure you put in Portage, otherwise you'll end up with Pathfinder Church in Missouri, and they're wonderful folks, but they're not us. And then, or you can also look it up on our Facebook page. You can find our sermons, our worship services on any of those three resources. And if you need help with that, just holler at us over at the Connect desk and we'll help you out. Anyway, in the grip of grace, praise God, each and every one of us are in the grip of grace. Because where would we be if we weren't? And so, hang on to that thought. Today we're going to talk about something that's a little concerning, I guess. We're going to talk about, like I said, one of the characters, and today's sermon is called Godless Living. Godless Living, living without God. All right? Our sermon text for today comes out of Romans chapter 1. It's the same exact text we read last week, verses 21 through 32. Same exact text we read last week, and it can be rough to hear because it speaks about our human condition. So listen to these words. Yes, they knew God, but they wouldn't worship Him as God or even give Him thanks. And they began to think up foolish ideas of what God was like. As a result, their minds became dark and confused. Claiming to be wise, they instead became utter fools. And instead of worshiping the glorious, ever-living God, they worshiped idols made to look like mere people and birds and animals and reptiles. So God abandoned them to do whatever shameful things their hearts desired. As a result, they did vile and degrading things with each other's bodies. They traded the truth about God for a lie. So they worshiped and served the things God created instead of the Creator Himself, who is worthy of eternal praise. Amen. That is why God abandoned them to their shameful desires. Even women turned against the natural ways to have sex and instead indulged in sex with each other. And the men, instead of having normal sexual relations with women, burned with lust for each other. Men did shameful things with other men, and as a result of this sin, they suffered within themselves the penalty they deserved. Since they thought it foolish to acknowledge God, He abandoned them to their foolish thinking and let them do things that should never be done. Their lives became full of every kind of wickedness, sin, greed, hate, envy, murder, quarreling, deception, malicious behavior, and gossip. They are backstabbers, haters of God, insolent, proud, and boastful. They invent new ways of sinning, and they disobey their parents. They refuse to understand, break their promises, are heartless, and have no mercy. They know God's justice requires that those who do these things deserve to die, yet they do them anyway. Worse yet, they encourage others to do them too. The word of God for the people of God. Are we thankful for that word? I asked that last week too, and I'll ask it again. Those are hard words to hear. Hard words to hear. So For a theme, I thought we would do something. I'm using a baseball / sporting analogy here with this. So the theme I wanted us to talk about today is the ideal of trading away God for something else. So here's our theme. When we trade away God, we trade down. We never trade up when we trade God away. We're always trading down. And so that's what I want you to think about. And so starting today, we'll take a character from last week's sermon. Each week we'll pick a different character, and we'll expound on each one in the hopes that we can learn something about our human condition and about ourselves as individuals. So yes, it's vitally important that you go and watch that sermon from last week. I can't encourage you enough to please go watch it when you have a chance. Anyway, we'll start with the mud and grass hut building brother today. You'll remember him. He was the first brother to kind of leave the fold, the mud and hut building brother. And we will refer to him as the hut building hedonist. Hut building hedonist. So that begs the question, well, what is a hedonist? And I want you to know this. I guess I should have said this before we started. Inside of your bulletin, if you grabbed one out from out there, there are some fill-in-the-blanks on the inside here. If you want to, if you're one of those kind of folks that likes to follow along and fill in the blanks, they're right there inside. So your first fill-in-the-blank is coming up right now. The hut-building hedonist. What is a hedonist? It's a person who thinks the pursuit of pleasure, that's your fill-in, person who thinks the pursuit of pleasure is the most important thing in life. Okay, that's what a hedonist is, pursuit of pleasure. All right, so let's examine, let's talk about why we're referring to the hut-building hedonist, or as a hut-building hedonist, and we have to think about his situation. We'll review his particular situation in just a minute. We'll remember from last week that the hut builder was the first one, and specifically, he's the one who forgot about the Father. He's the one who forgot about the Father. There may have been a once upon a time Father a long time ago, but he's been long forgotten. And there may even be an in the distant future Father, but as for today, the Son will live without him. The hut building hedonist will live without the ideal of the Creator or the Father. He basically is on his own and chooses to be that way. Okay. He forgot all about the wonderful mansion and castle home from which he came. He traded his passion for that castle for a love of the lowlands and all of the savages that lived within it. And rather than long for a home, he settled for a hut made out of mud and grass. Rather than longing for this castle, this beautiful place that he lived with his father, he now is settling for a mud and hut grass in the valley. In short, friends, the son will forge out a life of his own. Rather than seizing the future, the son settles for seizing the day. He gives up the future for the day. So think about that for a little bit as we go on further. And this is just the kind of person that the Apostle Paul is thinking about, is speaking about, when he wrote our text for today that we just read. Paul calls this godless living, that is, living without God, godless living, okay? And look at these harsh words again in that epistle, and I kind of tried to emphasize them when I was reading them, but let's think about them again. Romans 1:24, God abandoned them and let them do blank, blank, blank. Romans 1:26, God abandoned them to their shameful actions, blank, 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 on and on. Romans 1:28, God abandoned them to their foolish thinking. There's a theme beginning to build here. God abandoned them to their lustful desires, their shameful actions, their foolish thinking. Here's what I want us to hear this morning, one of the many things, but this one's really important. God is angry at evil. I know the church paints a picture of God as an all-loving God. He's all-lovey and ushy-gushy and, you know, everything's love, 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 love. And that's true. God is love. Don't get me wrong. But God, in his love and his holiness, hates evil. And that's a word we don't usually use with God. We don't like to use the word hates with God. But remember, our ideal of hate is different than God's, right? God just has to separate himself from evil, right? Our ideal of hate is a human ideal. But God hates evil. Make no mistake about this, friends. Romans 1:18 says this, God is against all sinful, wicked people who suppress the truth by their wickedness. Whoa. Again, taken right out of the scripture. Not Don Wolfgang's words. I want to be clear about this. These are scripture's words. God is against all sinful, wicked people who suppress the truth by their wickedness. The one who urges us to hate what is wrong and hold tightly to what is good, Romans 12:9, hates what is evil. Okay? I want to be clear about that. Just as our hut builder lived as if there was no father, remembering the story back, lived as if there was no father, a hedonist lives as if there's no creator at all. Okay? No creator. And again, Paul's word for this is godlessness, living without God. And beloved, there are consequences to this godless living. You can't just live without God and not have consequences associated with it. So here's the first one. We lose our standard. We lose our standard. Look at verse 21 there of our text. And they began to think up foolish ideas of what God was like. As a result, their minds became dark and confused. Folks, there's a lot of dark and confused people in our world today. By the way, remember when we were reading the text and it said they all the way down through the text? Who's the they? Who's the they? Come on. Yeah, hello. We have all fallen short of the glory of God. Isn't that our memory verse? All fall short of the glory of God. The they that Paul was talking about is we. Let's not forget that. Okay? So, let me give you a little story from my youth when I was I guess I must have been just early high school at the time. Long before I met Miss Jackie, so she's not the subject of this little story. When I was a teenager, a certain young lady had caught my eye. She's very cute. We hung out together a lot for a little while. And one day we were walking through the shops in our little town there in Lincoln Park, and she was looking at necklaces on one of those little, you know, turn it around, look at all the various different jewelry on it. And she was looking at necklaces. And then as I watched her, I suddenly became shocked. She looked to see where the clerk was. And then she took one of the necklaces and she slipped it into her purse. And I went, whoa. I mean, my parents had told me that's wrong, you know. And so I walked over to her and I whispered in her ear, you need to put that back. And she said, no. I want it, they can afford it, so I'm taking it. So we walked out, and a little while later we started talking about it as we were walking down the street, and I told her, I said, listen, I think what you did was wrong, you know? And she basically responded with the thought that it may be wrong for me, but for her it wasn't wrong. It's all relative. In her mind. In her world, there were no moral absolutes. Friends, this is the world of a hedonist. No moral absolutes. Live for the day. Live for self-satisfaction. That's what a hedonist does. Okay? And it may be great on paper, it might be great in a philosophy course, but as far as life is concerned, not so much. See, a godly view of the world, a Christian worldview, on the other hand, has something to say to my teenage friend all those years ago. Faith challenges us to answer to a higher standard than our personal opinion or our personal feelings. Faith calls us to a higher standard than our opinion or feelings. It's so important, I want to say it one more time. Faith calls us to a higher standard than our own opinion and our feelings. And our world has lost that. You may think it's right. Society might even say it's okay. But the God who made you said, "You shall not steal," and he wasn't kidding. That's why they're called commandments. He wasn't kidding. So I got to thinking about this, and I want to kind of challenge us to take this ideal of no moral absolutes to its logical conclusion. And where does that get us? Where do we go with no moral absolutes? Okay, well, the answer to that is written on a prison wall in Poland right now. The answer to that, here's what it says, and I quote, "I freed Germany from the stupid and degrading fallacies of conscience and morality." I freed Germany from the stupid and degrading fallacies of conscience and morality. Who said those words? Any idea? Hitler. Say it louder. Hitler. Adolf Hitler said those words. Adolf Hitler said those words. I freed him from the silliness of conscience and morality. Huh. So those very words are posted in a Nazi death camp in Poland. And visitors can go in and see those words, and then they go into the next room over, and it's filled with thousands of pounds of women's hair. All the hair that they shaved off of the 6 million Jews. Children, beware, parents. The next room over is filled with children who have been mutilated at those camps, pictures of them. The next room over is a window that looks out to the gas chamber, not in that particular one, but where 6 million people were suffocated to death. Now, I admit to you that it's a long step from a little, you know, taking a necklace and putting it in your purse all the way to the Holocaust. Okay? I recognize that's a long way to go. But it went there. It happened. The Holocaust is not a fallacy. So if there is no standard, no moral standard, if there is no God, if there is no good versus evil, then what's stopping the tide from rolling all the way to Holocaust? Max Lucado, in his book, In the Grip of Grace, said this, and I quote, "If society deletes God from the human equation, what sandbags will they stack against the swelling wave of barbarism and hedonism?" So the first thing we lose in godless living is our standard of good and evil. And then we lose our purpose. We lose our purpose. Claiming to be wise, they instead became utter fools. Purposeless. Have you ever thought about what your purpose in life is? Have you ever really sat down and thought about, what is my purpose in life? Why am I here? Why did God see fit to put me on this planet? That's a great question for us to ask ourselves. So let me give you some of the ideas that humans have thought about as their purpose in life, okay? First one is that we find meaning in our lives through our vocation, through what we do for a living, okay? And there's a lot of people out there that do that. You know, I want to be a dentist. I want to be a teacher. I want to be a firefighter. I want to be in the military. I mean, any of those are good. They're all good things. I'm not saying they're not good things. And they're fine professions, but none of them are a justification for our existence. I mean, they're all good stuff, don't get me wrong, like I said, but they're not justification for our existence. See, Max says, again in his book, they opt to be a human doing rather than a human being. Doing rather being. So often, who we are is what we do, so the result is we do a lot. People stay at work for all kinds of hours in the day because if they don't, they don't have an identity. I'm not anything if I'm not my, you know, person at work. And so they spend gobs and gobs and gobs of hours working instead of being a human. Now, still others find their identity wrapped up in what they have, okay? Meaning comes from a new car. Meaning comes from a new house. You know, we got to move another house up. We got to move another house up. Meaning comes from new clothes or jewelry or whatever, okay? Meaning comes from what I have, the stuff. I have meaning in that. Now I'm going to get myself in trouble, so please bear with me. Still others find meaning in the lives of their children. They live vicariously through their children. The next beauty pageant, the next softball tournament, the next whatever. My kid's going to be the next Babe Ruth or the next Michael Jordan or the next Emma Stone or that kind of thinking. And believe me, softball, beauty pageants, all this. Nothing, again, nothing wrong with those things until they become the number one thing in your life. If they usurp all of your time, all of your energy, if you don't have time for God because you're at the weekend soccer tournament, you ought to be asking yourself. Some others try sports. Some others try entertainment, some try cults, some try sex, and the list goes on and on and on and on. All of this, according to Paul, is foolish thinking. Have any of you all read The Purpose-Driven Life book? A couple of you. All right, two or three of you. All right. So what is the very opening line of The Purpose-Driven Life book? What's the opening line? It's not about you. Exactly. Exactly. Thank you, Jan. It's not about you. Or me. It's not about me. Our purpose in life has nothing to do with me. Here's what he says. Rick Warren goes on to say this. The purpose of your life is far greater than your own personal fulfillment, your peace of mind, or even your happiness. It's more than that. It's far greater than your family, your career, or even the wildest dreams and ambitions. If you want to know why you were placed on this planet, you must begin with God. You were born by His purpose and for His purpose. That's why you're here. By His purpose, God chose for you to be here. By His purpose and for His purpose. To do what He has for you to do. And this idea flies in the face of the hedonist world. Hedonist doesn't want to hear anything like that. Because his or her world is all about their own pleasure. And certainly not about what God has planned for them. In another letter that Paul wrote, we're reading through Romans right now. We're going to read quite a bit through Romans in this sermon series. But in Ephesians, Paul says this, Ephesians 2:10, You are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so we can do the good things He planned for us long ago. Friends, you are God's artwork. Every last one of you is God's artwork. You're His masterpiece. And He wants you, He's created you in His image so that you can do the good works He has planned for you. But your worth isn't in the good works you do. Your worth is in whose you are, with a capital W, whose, as in God, you are. So a godless life causes us to lose our standard, it causes us to lose our purpose, and then finally it causes us to lose our worship. Verse 23, and instead of worshiping the glorious, ever-living God, they worshiped idols made to look like mere people and birds and animals and reptiles. Verse 23 there. I love the way the message paraphrase says this verse because it makes it so much more poignant. Here it is in the message. They traded the glory of God who holds the whole world in His hands for any cheap figurines you can buy at any roadside stand. And then think about that for a minute. You traded the God who holds the whole world in His hands, all of creation, the whole universe for that matter, not just the world, but everything that's been created for a few trinkets that you can buy made in China on the side of the road. Junk. That's what he's saying. Have you ever wondered, this is something that's really bugged me. Look around you for a second, please. I mean, I realize this is a holiday weekend and it's kind of a low attendance week, but look around. Go ahead, look around quickly. Just look around. Okay? There's a whole bunch of empty seats in here today. Okay? I mean, we're just going to be honest with ourselves today. There's a bunch of empty seats. Hopefully, there's a bunch of people watching us online. But have you ever wondered why the worship of God seems to be diminishing here in our country and in our modern world, for that matter, in some places, many places? Some other places, it's booming. But here in the United States and in most of Europe, the worship of God is just spiraling down. Have you ever wondered why? You know, we get thinking about this. We know more now, gobs and gobs more now than we did 100 years ago. We know gobs and gobs more than we knew 10 years ago. And in fact, you know, via electronics and those kinds of things, we know leaps and bounds more than what we knew 2 years ago. Okay? We know more information about the world, about how the world works. We know more information about the universe. You know, we know more about the depths of the oceans. We know more now than we've ever known in our lives as humanity. We have made discovery after discovery after discovery. We've mapped our solar system. Take a look at this picture. Throw that picture up there for me. That's a picture that our own Steve Buscema took with a camera and a little telescope in his front yard. Look at that. Isn't that amazing? I mean, it's just amazing. We know more. We can do more. We can see more. We can think more. We can understand more. We've sent probes into deep space and landed on Mars. We've had hearts transplanted from one human being to another to save a life and many other vital organs as well. We've descended into the abyss of the Monterey Bay Trench and found creatures that we never knew existed before. Creatures that can exist without any sunlight whatsoever. For the longest time, we thought everything had to do photosynthesis. Everything had to have the sunshine in order to survive. Guess what? We found out there's creatures way down at the bottom of the trench that have never seen sunlight. They don't know what it is. We have discovered all kinds of amazing facts about our world. Mysteries are unfolding by the second in our modern world. Yet, for some reason, the loss of mystery has resulted in a loss of majesty. Mystery's going away as we learn more and more, and for some reason, majesty is going with it. The more we know, the less we believe. As a human race, Isn't that strange? I think that's strange, Pastor Jake. I don't know, maybe nobody else does, but I think that's really strange. I think the more we know, the knowledge of the workings of the universe shouldn't negate our wonder at all. I think, on the other hand, it should stir up wonder and amazement even more, knowing that something created all of that. Someone created all of that. I mean, who has, you know, Max asked the question in his book, who has more reason to believe in God than an astronaut who has seen the stars up close? Who has more reason to believe in God than a surgeon who's held a heart in her hand, a beating human heart that she was about to put into someone else? Who has more reason to believe in God than an oceanographer who is in the depths of the ocean and hears whale song from thousands of miles away? The more we know, the more we should be amazed. And this isn't true in our world today, in many cases at least. Why? Because of our second fill in the blank. The hedonist worships the creation rather than the creator. We tend to worship the knowledge we have and our ability to transfer that heart rather than the creator of that heart and the one who gave us a mind so that we could learn how to transfer that heart and save another person's heart. We worship the creation rather than the creator. We've become so impressed with our knowledge and our ability that we forget that there's a creator behind it. Ironically, the more we know, the less humanity seems to worship. And that's what we lose when we live a life of hedonism. According to the first chapter of Romans, godlessness is a bad swap. It's a bad trade. The hut-building hedonist destroys his hope of living in the Father's castle simply by living for today only. He's satisfied with what he's got for today. If there's no standard in his life, there's no purpose in this life other than self-fulfillment, and there's nothing sacred in this life to worship, then what is to keep us from doing whatever we want? Ergo Adolf Hitler. And are we not seeing this come true on the news every single time we turn it on in our world today? So what are we to do? What are we, as the people of God, to do about what we've just heard? Well, I can tell you this, we pray it often. Whenever we pray the Lord's Prayer, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, where? On earth as it is in heaven, right? What are we to do? We are to live as if heaven has come to earth. Even though it isn't yet, even though we're still waiting for that day, whenever it will be, come Lord Jesus, we're still waiting, but that's how we're supposed to live our lives, as if heaven has come to earth. We're to be the example for the hedonist world out there that is all wrapped up in itself. How can we do that? There are just gobs and gobs away. One of the ways is coming up here on the 11th of July. We can go serve the community over there at the apartment complex who are less fortunate than most of us and just serve them. That's one way. It's the very unselfish thing to do. It's anti-hedonism at its best. That's one way. There's gobs and gobs of others. You have to ask yourself what that means for you in your context, for you in your household, and I would ask you to think about what we can do here as a church body to do that as well. You come up with some ideas, holler at me, please, or any of the staff. Our hut-building hedonist lays a trail of poor decision-making swaps. Think about it for a minute in our first sermon and today. He traded his mansion, his castle, for a valley ghetto of mud and grass. He traded in the mansion for mud and was satisfied with it. He traded his brother, the eldest who came to get him, you remember from last week, for a bunch of strangers, the savages that lived in the land. He traded his father for a hedonistic lifestyle that focused solely on himself and his own pleasure. Here's your last fill in the blank. Hedonists make poor swaps or trades. Here's the other thing I want us to hear today. We all have a little hedonism in each and every one of us. We are all a little bit of a hedonist. Why do I know that? Why can I say that with confidence? Because we all fall short of the glory of God, every last one of us, all of us. It is our human nature to be self-centered at times in our lives. And so we all deal with it. Some more so than others, clearly. So here's what I want you to ask yourself this week. What have you traded for God? Where have you pawned God off, traded for something else? That's what I want you to think about this week. That's what I'm going to think about this week. What have I traded off God off for in my life? Because our theme is clear. When we trade God away, we're trading down. We're not going up. Guaranteed. We're going down. So what have you traded God for in your life? And how can you rectify that? One more character again next week. Amen? Jake, come lead us in prayer.
In just a few moments, we're going to participate in one of the foundations of our faith, in communion. So if you're joining us online, I would ask you to get your elements ready so you can participate in with us. But before we do that, we get the chance to live that out as we pray for each other, and as we walk alongside each other through difficult times and through good ones too. So I'm going to read our prayer cards for today. First one comes from Pat and Tanya Murphy, and they are asking for prayers. Tanya has been having migraines again recently, and they're just asking that you would pray for them, that they would find the cause of that, and that would be resolved quickly. And they're also asking for prayers in their own marriage, just as we would ask for in our own relationships, that we would reflect Jesus and in the relationships that we have with everyone. Next one comes from Justin and Kayla Abel. They say, please keep in mind the family and friends of Chris Darnell, who is the semi-truck racing driver at the Battle Creek air show that passed away tragically this weekend. So be in prayer for his friends and family and for all of those who witnessed that tragedy, as well as Justin's mom and dad, who are losing a dear friend to cancer. So please be in prayer for them and their family as they're in hospice care and beginning to come to the end of their life. Our next one comes from Halo Porecki. She says, please pray for Mike and Amber Lester as their newborn daughter went from the mother's womb to the hands of Jesus. Please pray for comfort and for hugs for their family. Last one today comes from Bubba, and he's just asking for prayer for himself and the cast as they get ready to put on their play on Friday. Let's pray together. Jesus, you are an amazing God, and we are so incredibly thankful that you hear us when we come to you in prayer. Jesus, it's clear that there are a lot of things that are on the hearts and minds of people that are really, really hard. We know that you love us and you meet us in those hard times. So that is the cry of our hearts today, Jesus. Meet us where we are. Meet us in the difficulties, in the struggles, and in the hard times. And help us to carry those burdens with you. But you also tell us that we don't have to carry those by ourselves. So my prayer is that you call people to walk alongside each other that are going through difficult times. Jesus, help us to lift our eyes from the step that's in front of us and to look to our left and to our right, to see the people that are hurting and that are going through difficult times. Give us the courage and the love to extend our hands to them and to help walk alongside of them and with them through their difficult moments. Jesus, this is a difficult life that you've called us to live. But you've said that we don't have to live it alone. We can live it with each other, and we can live it with you. So please help us to do that. Help us to not just spend this time that we're gathered here together with you, but help us to spend moments each and every day to come to you, to spend with you, to get to know you more. Because that's how we live a life that's on full, a life of abundance. Jesus, please help us to do that this week. Help us to go to you. Help it to be the cry of our hearts that we want to know you more and be with you more. Because we love you, Jesus. Please help us to worship you as we leave this time and this place and to give you everything that we are, because you're worthy of that. We love you, Jesus. Amen.
I neglected to mention that I have my beautiful daughter-in-law with me. Evelyn is sitting up here, and my grandbaby is in the nursery, so I'm grateful for that. So just wanted to say hi. Say hi, Evelyn. I say this every single time we serve communion here, and I want to make sure that everybody understands this. This table was set by our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ for his people and anyone who would acknowledge him. And so everyone is welcome at this table. You do not need to be a member of this church to come here. You are welcome here because Jesus set this table for everyone, not just members of this church. All right? I want to be clear about that so that everybody understands. So on the night when he gave himself up for us, he took bread and he broke it and he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat this. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And then at the end of the supper, he took the cup and he held it up and blessed it to his Father and he said, "This is my blood which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Take and drink this as often as you shall in remembrance of me." And so we believe in an open communion table. We believe that this is, that the presence of Jesus Christ is here with us in a spiritual way at this table. And we commune, that's why it's called communion. We commune with Jesus in this moment, in this time. So I'm going to ask my praise band to come up first, please, and they can bring their family with them if they would like. But our praise band can come up so they can lead us in music as we get ready. We will hand you a piece of bread and a cup. The bread and body and bread of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And I do have gluten-free elements if you need them. I'm sorry, I forgot to mention that as well. The body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Body and blood of our Lord. Yes, you may. The rest of you, if you would come through the center aisle and then return out to the outer aisle.
Never empty. Body and blood of
For worshiping with us today. Receive this blessing. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, may the love of God the Father, and may the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And all God's people said,
Amen.
Amen. Have a great day. 1, 2.